Good afternoon. Hi. My name is Eric Crosby, the curator of the exhibition Ordinary Pictures, which just opened today and we celebrated last night. Welcome. I'm happy to introduce today's speaker, an artist included, featured very prominently in the exhibition, and an artist who figured very prominently in my thinking and conceptualization around it. Ordinary Pictures takes as its point of departure the phenomenon of the stock photograph and considers more broadly the industrial conditions of image production that shape our visual culture, including film and photographic work from the 1960s to the present. And it really only seems appropriate that Morgan Fisher should have such a prominent place in the show. Few artists have probed the intersection of art and industry as much as Morgan has, and as incisively as he has. I'd like to thank Aaron and Carol Mack, the generous supporters of this program, as well as Misa Jeffries of the Visual Arts Department for organizing it. I'll give you a little background on our speaker, who will fill in the holes himself. Morgan Fisher, an artist and filmmaker, was born in Washington, D.C. in 1942. He received a bachelor's degree in art history from Harvard, then studied film production in Los Angeles. His films have been shown at international festivals, Berlin, Rotterdam, London, and so many others, and in one-person screenings and exhibitions at Tate Modern, Museum of Modern Art in New York, the Whitney Museum of American Art, and so many others. In the early 1990s, he started making works on paper, paintings, sculptures, really expanding the repertoire. One-person exhibitions that included examples of such work include Porticus, Raven Row, the Generali Foundation, and recently the Aspen Art Museum. He's also been exhibiting photographs, some of which are included in the exhibition upstairs. He was in the 1985, 2004, and 2014 Whitney Biennials. A collection of his writings was recently published in 2012 by Walter Koenig, and it's absolutely required reading for anybody interested in film, photography, and Ordinary Pictures more broadly. So here's a little note about our program. We'll be screening a film. Morgan will come up before and make some remarks, and then we'll have a conversation about his work over the past four decades. So please help me welcome Morgan Fisher.
Eric, thank you so much. Thank you, Eric, and for including me and for inviting me to be here. And Misa, thank you so much for all that you've done to help make all this happen. Just very briefly, I'll do the arithmetic for you. I'm 73 years old, and I'm a child of the 60s, and I'm extraordinarily grateful for that because I became an adult, artistically speaking, in, I would say, just after the middle of the 60s, from around 1966 is when I came into something like maturity. And the reigning idioms in the visual arts at that time were minimalism and conceptualism. And I just want to remind us of what Saul LeWitt said in his essay, Paragraphs on Conceptual Art. He said that an idea is a machine that makes the work. So I emphasize that the origin is an idea, but then the idea is given material as if by a machine. And I lay emphasis on the idea of the machine because a machine does its work automatically, so to speak. And I didn't go to art school. I went to film school, but I didn't finish. I went to the University of Southern California for a year, which totally embraced the Hollywood model. And then I went to UCLA for less than a semester, and that was the end of my education. And then a couple of years passed, and I started making my own work. And for a while, I worked in the commercial film industry as an editor. So I'm mentioning this to lay out a kind of territory in relation to which my work can be understood. So conceptualism, yes, but minimalism, yes, but, or minimalism in several forms. The commercial industry, yes, but, which I think is what this film you're about to see is about. It's about an ambivalent relationship to the commercial motion picture industry. And a fourth term would be so-called independent film, yes, but. So the film we're going to see is called Production Stills, which, as you recognize, is a term from the commercial motion picture industry. There are stills taken during a production to show us behind the scenes, the actor having a cigarette break while the director talks to him, for example, or the director next to the camera making gestures to show what the angle is that he or she would like. It's an industry term, which of course has flowed over into production more generally, like non-commercial filmmaking. It was made in 1970, and it's 11 minutes long, and it's the length that it is because that is the length of a standard roll of film in 16 millimeter. It's 400 feet, which is a standard load, and if you've seen the show, you already know that I have an interest in standard quantities when it comes to film. The photographs are photographs of boxes of film, still film, and this film was made with a roll of 16 millimeter, which came in a box. I mean, you opened the box, and there was the can, and in the can was the film. So it's a standard unit, and the standard unit determined the length of the film. So this implies a way of working that I would locate under the sign of construction rather than composition, which in turn would align my work more with conceptualism and minimalism. I think that's enough. I did tell Eric I would be brief. So Production Stills, 1970, 11 minutes. And then Eric and I will have a conversation. So thank you so much for coming. And what do they say? See you after the show. Yeah. So excellent. Thank you.
Let's put it down on the ground.
Perfect. Ready?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll take it out.
Speak up.
Oh, perfect.
Is it all right?
Yeah. Fine. Yeah, it's very good balance. Thank you.
going to get this morning?
Good. Make sure it's aimed properly.
Good. The white flecks are not showing up.
That's 3 minutes. I'm sorry, it's 2.5. I take it back.
Morning, you want to get in the shot?
Okay, where? Hello, Chris?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay, fine.
How's the exposure on this?
Fine, yeah.
They're
just a pinch light, but take another one, we'll see. Is that normal? Is that middle? No, it's close. It's close.
No, it wasn't.
Where was it? Which side was it?
Light.
Okay, well, here, go ahead.
Oh, go ahead. Darken it just a little then.
Yeah.
Okay, 3.25 there.
You're doing okay.
How many is this? This is 3?
This is the third one going up.
Okay. Okay, it's 4 minutes. We're doing fine. We're ahead.
Okay, just a sec.
That looks pretty.
That's perfect.
I look like I'm humpbacked.
Oh, that won't do at all. Want to check the ceiling? They're doing all right. That's pretty good. That's really good. Okay, it's 5 minutes. How many is that?
That's the fourth one up.
Okay, fine.
Okay, John.
John?
This one's
going to
move here.
Is it on the light? Is it lighter? It should be lightened.
No, it should be dark.
You're right, I'm sorry. Are you advising on framing, John, or is it okay?
It's all right.
I just want to look at this picture.
Oh! Oh,
that's really great.
They're straight, aren't they?
Yeah.
Sort of tilted from mine.
Yeah, it does a little. I can't really tell.
Well, your best, you know, whatever your best...
It's close. It's very close.
It'll do. How many minutes? I mean, how many?
That's the fifth one up.
Okay. Okay, 6.5, Tom. You'll have to do one.
Level. It's okay.
Okay. Yeah, 7.5. How many shots is that? That's 6?
This is 7.
Is the 7th going up? Yeah.
It is? I wouldn't really know. You look like someone sneaked in upon you, Nancy.
Oh.
Look like you're eavesdropping. You know, you shouldn't really be there.
So this is the last picture being taken now.
Duh. John. That's 8.
Are we on the 8th picture now?
Yeah. I was reacting to that shot. Is this the last one?
Yeah.
Okay,
I'll take
it.
It's popped.
Okay.
Were they good pictures?
Yeah.
How was that one? Okay, Tom, why don't you, what time is it?
It's, 8:50. So you better take one.
Yeah.
You have plenty of time left?
Yeah. 2 minutes.
Oh, good.
There's only one picture left in the roll.
Okay, now, Tom, I have no notion to this. Do whatever you think is appropriate. You just want to be recorded for...
Yeah, right.
Take it.
You want just yourself or a wider shot?
Whatever you want.
Okay, let's do a wide shot. Do you already have a wide shot?
We'll take it. Remember to lighten it, though.
Yeah.
Do that? Lighten it all the way.
Yeah, lighten it all the way.
There.
At least it has time in it.
No, I mean, I was thinking of something else.
Well,
I mean, what happened to your figure?
No, that happened.
How many minutes?
4 shortening?
Yeah.
Almost 10.
Did it.
10:30.
Okay, fine. We're just...
Do you want
to leave
it?
Yeah, we got
how much film is left?
15 feet. See if I can tell right when we're running out. At least we got Tom there. You don't mind if he's... But, 8 feet out of you.
Okay.
Can I say a couple of things about the film?
Yeah, of course.
All right. Hollywood. That's the Hollywood production model. It's a Moviola Crab Dolly, which is a standard piece of equipment. The camera is a Mitchell. It's a 16mm Mitchell, and Mitchell for many years was the standard studio camera, now succeeded by Panavision. And the sound boom was a Fisher sound boom, as it happens. That's a standard industry instrument. So it embraces the means of the industry. I mean, this is so obvious. It embraces the means of the industry to do something rather different than what Hollywood films ordinarily do, which, of course, is to make you forget about the apparatus, the panoply of equipment that is necessary to bring you this image, which succeeds in making you forget about all those people off camera, all that equipment. I hope you could tell that there was a certain amount of panic going on during the production. The idea of the film The machine that made it was that we would expose a pack of 8 Polaroid photographs. The Polaroids at that time of 107 came in a pack of 8. So we had to take 8 photographs within this one standard unit had to be consumed or used up, so to speak, within the limits of another standard unit. And this, in fact, was the second take. The first take, the photographer didn't get the 8th shot. So there was some anxiety there. So in a funny way, it's a suspense film, although it's in a rather oblique form, let's say. And again, I don't want to insult anyone's intelligence, but as you can tell, I didn't take the picture, someone else did. So I, the putative maker of the film, gave responsibility to someone else to take the pictures, which were in fact the specific topographical, let's call them, images that you in fact saw. So I was happy to have someone else do that. And that is completely consistent with my interest in what I will call depersonalizing, or making work that is depersonalized, which is consistent with the model of construction, which, as I tried to explain at the beginning, I think, in my understanding of it, owes a very great deal to minimalism. And so there are these two modules. There's the module of the roll of film, and there's the modules of the Polaroids, which are, from the point of view of size, they are 8 identical objects, one after the other, which is almost the definition of a minimalist sculpture. But again, it's present in a way that doesn't hit you over the head. There was a time when I said that this film bore a relation to Duchamp, in that Duchamp's ready-mades are all industrially produced objects. I believe, I mean, some are modified, but they start out as industrially produced objects. And this is a film made of 2 ready-mades. But, I mean, who doesn't want to associate themselves with Duchamp? So I hope I'm not committing a great crime in making that claim. But anyway, so that's what I would have to say about the film for now. And should we go on to other things?
Yeah, we should take actually, well, we first of all need the projector. Oh, yeah. Well, take a step back.
Okay, yeah, what do you know? Rolls of film. A work on paper that I made in 1968, 2 years before I made production stills. And this is 2 rolls of double X negative and 2 rolls of tri-X negative. And the boxes for 100-foot spools of 16-millimeter film. So it's a picture of industrially produced units. Presented rather abstractly, in fact, because the technique was to cut paper stencils and then Krylon industrial spray paint. And it's sort of an addition. I think I made maybe 2 of this, but they're not identical because the spraying is not precise, and when you spray, it blows it lifts the stencil up, and so you get this nice fuzzy edge on one side, but then a hard edge on the other side. And I think that this work represents perfectly my wish to somehow combine minimalism and pop art. I mean, you can think of Warhol's Brillo boxes as minimalist objects that happen to have paint on them. Judd, I think, is hugely important for me. This combines pop and minimalism. And also, as I was mentioning to Eric earlier, there's a piece by Robert Morris. I don't know the title, but it's 4 very low boxes about these proportions, curiously enough, quite low in relation to these dimensions, width and length. There are 4 of them, and they can be shown either all put together or else slightly pulled apart, rather as these are pulled apart. And the very specific graphic technique I used was isometric drawing, which is the parallels don't converge as they do in perspective. They remain parallel forever. And in perspective, you have unlimited choice as to how you see an object, like where you put the camera, so to speak. Although many subjects more or less limit the choice, in principle, it could be the choice is infinite. In isometric, you can view an object from one of eight positions. So isometric was and remains for me an enormously powerful technique, precisely because it so drastically limits your choices. And for this work, I wanted to show the top of the boxes, the tops, and the fronts. And so the choices were reduced to two, whether it's the left-hand edge that's nearest us or the left-hand corner or the right-hand corner. So it's one of two choices. So I was a happy guy that isometric was there for me to not have to make choices.
So is this one of the earliest examples of finding ways to avoid having to compose the work that you can recall?
Yes, exactly, yeah. Well, I should mention that isometric, I mean, perspective is really hard to do, at least it is for me. And my father was an architect, and he taught me isometric in 10 minutes. So I can teach you isometric. Later on, if anyone wants to learn how to do isometric, I'll be happy to tell you. But it's very simple, and it's extremely powerful, theoretically. For example, in a perspective, it implies the space that the object is in. And I don't think that's true of isometric. It's not necessarily an object. It doesn't imply the space that it seems to surround it, I don't think. But apparently architects debate about this. I was actually talking to someone. He said this is a subject of debate, like the nature, the relation between an isometric drawing and the space that it appears to be in.
So Morgan, say a word about the subject matter too. I mean, these are film boxes, and you were in film school or nearly out of film school.
Yeah, I've been out of film school for 2 years, and I started to make films, and the first film I made consisted of rolls of 16 millimeter. So I was embracing the module then. And I kept making mistakes, so I had a lot of film boxes around. The first film, it was actually five rolls. It was five 100-foot rolls of film in their entirety.
So if we jump forward again to production stills, I'm curious to know the context of a work like this for you. Does this kind of film have a political dimension for you at all?
Well, in a very loose sense, I would say, to the extent that I'm sort of making, I think I'm patting myself on the back more than I should, but to the extent that it uses the means of Hollywood it turns the means of Hollywood against the Hollywood model. I mean, I think we can call that a political idea in a very loose sense, in that it, invisible production represents, it's about power, it's about creating work that people are happy to submit to. I think that's one of the reasons that we go, I mean, I love movies, like normal movies, I love them. But one of the reasons that we go to the movies, I think, is because they do our thinking for us. People who make commercial movies have already determined in advance how you're going to react to it. And to the extent that that's so and that's the model, then it's a successful film. Although I will mention that that is my experience in movies less and less, and that is I don't react to a film the way the people who made it want me to. For example, on the plane, I came from Los Angeles yesterday, and on the plane I was looking at people ahead of me watching the new James Bond film. And I don't think I was reacting to that film the way the people who made it wanted me to react.
Sort of perverse reaction to
it? It was just, how can anyone take this seriously for 1 second? That was my reaction. But to go back to an older example, a section man I had when I was in college was asked to leave a screening of the Ten Commandments because he couldn't stop laughing. So even at Hollywood in its moment of, to me, its greatest glory, or the last gasp of its moment of glory, there were people who were not entirely seduced, let's say, by what Hollywood films did.
So I asked the question about a kind of political dimension because, you know, I'm thinking of 1969, 1970, various forms of filmmaking out there on the horizon, avant-garde filmmaking. You might think of someone, European art cinema, Jean-Luc Godard. How did you imagine and sort of position your work in relation to other contexts of making at the time? Or perhaps you didn't.
Thank you for springing this on me. Yes.
This is carefully rehearsed.
Okay. There are several things to say. First of all, I adored Godard. I think the early films are just absolutely amazing, starting with Breathless. They're truly, truly remarkable and very important, but of course it's not. That doesn't mean that we try to make Godard in our own way. But someone did once criticize me for not responding to the times in which I made this film and some of the others, for example. The assassination of Bobby Kennedy. There were the police riots during the Democratic National Convention in the summer of 1968. And people criticized me. Like, why wasn't I making movies? I forgot what the exact words were, but it was like, why wasn't I making movies about the world around me? Well, this isn't a flip answer, but, you know, I don't think anyone ever complained about Donald Judd for not making art that was about the world around him. And in fact, the work that we do see, the visual work that we do see from that period that attempts to deal directly with politics, I think is not regarded as being as successful, although people recognize it for having good intentions and for being noble and so on. But there was Newsreel. I mean, there was an organization called Newsreel, and they were committed to documenting social protest and trying to animate a public consciousness. But it was given to me, I would say, and that sounds like I'm trying to avoid taking responsibility. It was given to me to do what I did, and I'm not going to apologize for it. As I say, there's the model of minimalist art, for example, or Saul LeWitt, for that matter. I mean, Saul LeWitt, I think, contributed his work to fundraisers for anti-war activism, for example, and he signed petitions, things like that. But I'll mention another example. There's a filmmaker I admire immensely, perhaps more than anyone else now living, and that's Jean-Marie Straub, who for many years made his films with his wife Danielle Huillier, who's no longer living. But Straub made a film, I forget the date, called The Chronicle of Anna Magdalena Bach, and it was based on the letters that the wife of Johann Sebastian Bach wrote. And I haven't seen it in many years. It was made, I think, in 1966. And a lot of the film is people in period costume with wigs playing musical instruments. And people criticized Straub for making this film. Now, he had also made very, very political films. He made a film about the resurgence of Nazism based on a novel by Heinrich Böll called Not Reconciled, which is a great film. And he said that The Chronicle of Anna Magdalena Bach was his contribution. It was an anti-war film. I forget his exact words, but he defended it as being an expression of anti-war sentiment. And he explained this by saying that it represented the power of individual commitment, in this case, the commitment of Bach and his wife. Now, whether you're convinced by that or not, I don't know, but this was an extremely intelligent man who said this, who also went on to make films that were explicitly about things like war guilt, for example. There's a short called An Introduction to Arnold Schoenberg's Accompaniment to a Cinematographic Scene, which is about 20 minutes long, and it's one of the great anti-war films, and it ends with newsreel footage of napalm being dropped on in Vietnam, and it deals with the question of, you know, who is guilty, or how is it that the people who are guilty, in fact, are never found guilty. It's a great film.
So at the time that you were making works like production stills, the term structural film was very much in the air. Can you talk about how you identified or didn't identify with the definition that P. Adam Sidney set forth?
Why, yes, I'd be happy to. In 1969, P. Adam Sidney wrote a brief article published in Film Culture called Structural Film. And we have to go back. Let me take you back to the time. American independent film, experimental film, whatever we want to call it, at the time was conducted under the sign of a very small group of people in New York. They controlled a magazine called Film Culture, and they also controlled an exhibition space called
the Filmmakers Co-op.
Well, and then the Filmmakers Co-op was a distribution arm, and then there was Anthology Cinema, which showed films. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, Anthology somehow crystallized itself into a canon of essential cinema, but that was to come later. So P. Adam Sidney wrote an essay about structural film, and he announced it as this new tendency. And I was mentioned in a footnote, and I thought, gosh, this is wonderful it's by happenstance. The work I happened to be doing happened to accord with this model that this guy in New York had announced as the new thing. And he identified certain people, and I was added as a footnote. Then it was reprinted, and I was no longer mentioned. Well, them's the breaks.
It begs the question, how structural is the work, right?
Well, and P. Adam Sidney specified there are four conditions that are the identifying traits of structuralism. They're all different from each other in a funny way.
Can we name them? Loop printing.
This is an acid flashback.
I'm sorry. Yeah, I know it's like an inquisition. I can't name them myself, but they're stylistic codes. It doesn't really speak to the broader tendency or the inward reflexive focus of your
exactly.
work.
Yeah, exactly. Well, yeah. It suited him. I mean, there was a bunch of people. They were all deserving people. I mean, Michael Snow, Hollis Frampton, Paul Scharz, Owen Land, Barry Gerson, and Joyce Wieland. And as it happens, they all lived in New York, or most of them. And I once actually wrote an essay about this called "Missing the Boat," and it was people who have careers in the arts they enjoy it because it's about the pain of discovering that one is not thought of as one would like to be thought of. This is a case of sour grapes if ever there was one. It's like, well, it's okay, because what it means is I haven't been historicized with those people. I'm not back there with these people who's are fixed at a certain moment in history. I'm somehow free of that. So anyway.
Well, it seems one interesting distinction is the coastal divide, right? I mean, if structural film was a largely New York phenomenon, here you're working like within and adjacent to an industry that was, you know, 3,000 miles away from the other filmmakers camp.
Yeah, although when the canon came along, which, as I say, there was this, there was a little committee. They got together and they created what they called the essential cinema. And it included a lot of these people as like the last, this was when history ended, because I think, in fact, they no more were added after these people. It's a very curious thing to be in control of a history that somehow you're not able to add on to, but in fact ends with a school or a style or a tendency that you yourself, or at least P. Adam Sidney, one of the people who was a member of this committee, had in fact announced. And I mean, all of a sudden things started to happen that this group of people could no longer control. For example, there was the whole like Lower East Side scene, like the whole film scene and music scene happened all of a sudden, and they were in reaction to what they regarded as the academicism of a lot of the structuralist work. In fact, my work was once criticized in print, thanks October Magazine.
By Journal, October Journal.
Journal, yes, yes. There was a man named Scott McDonald who did, one of his things was to do interviews with people who made movies, and he interviewed Scott and Beth B., who wore black blue jeans and t-shirts. And so they were committed Lower East Side people. And one of the things you do when you're young and up and coming is you turn on the people who are the generation before you. It's just, it's natural. I mean, this is how you sort of define yourself, is by rejecting what has gone before you. And Scott McDonald, thanks Scott, brought my name up to these people. And one of them, I think Scott B., dismissed me with describing my work, I will euphemistically say was self-involved. But when you think about it, when I think about that, that's okay because it actually brings my films closer to certain models that I admire in abstract painting. For example, Robert Ryman. Robert Ryman's paintings are paintings about the process of their own making.
We'll get there, though. We'll get to
paint. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Hold on.
But
don't move too fast.
Okay. So, yeah. So my films were, on the one hand, criticized for not being, you know, about political issues. I hope I've addressed that. Another person complained about them for being not about, you know, being tough and being on the Lower East Side, which they most assuredly are not. But, you know, I can sympathize. That's what you do. You turn on the piece. No, it's like I rejected someone like Stan Brakhage. When I started doing my work, I rejected Stan Brakhage. It just, I did something else. I didn't do that other thing in order to reject Stan Brakhage. It just, I saw Stan Brakhage. He was very important to me. I loved the work. The first film I ever saw of his was Desist Film, which I probably saw in like 1960 or 61. It made a huge impression on me. Then time passed, I grew up, and I started making my work. It was different.
And your work has an incredibly different tone than the lyrical abstraction work of Stan Brakhage. I mean, we're looking at a still from Picture and Sound Rushes from 1972 now. 73.
Yes.
Picturing the artist himself. So this is a work that I think really embodies the kind of didactic or instructional quality of the work. I mean, there's a way in which you are demonstrating essential functions of the cinema and mapping this apparatus from one film to the next.
Yes, that's correct.
And so
shall I go on? I mean, I could actually see.
Yeah, you should. Okay. No, maybe you could relay the kind of the structure of this film in particular, because it speaks very much to your evocation of a LeWitt earlier, machine that makes the work.
Oh, exactly. Okay, great. Just to go back a little bit, there was a time when there was this magazine called Film Culture, and there was a time when they were simply concerned with artists who worked in cinema, even if they were in the industry. But that's where, those of you who know Andrew Saras's book, The American Cinema, in which he lays out in book form the canon and of the auteurs. This was first published in Film Culture. And one of the issues I saw in the early 60s was in the form of frame stills, and it was the scene from the beginning of the Sam Fuller film. Oh, my God. With Constance Powers. Anyway, the
Shock
opening...
Shock Corridor?
No, it was after Shock Corridor.
Naked
Kiss, naked. Thank you. Yes, at the opening sequence of The Naked Kiss, where a prostitute is beating up her pimp.
This is required viewing also. You should go rent it immediately.
And And so here's Sam Fuller, who I point out is not in the Pantheon in Saras, but is in, I think he's in.
He's in one of the.
He's up there. It might be the far side of paradise, but, or maybe Expressive Esoterica.
Oh, maybe.
Anyway, so here's Sam Fuller, who's a Hollywood director, but like sort of like a B director. And so here's this in film culture where these the sequence of stills, and as Fuller later explained, he had the actress hit the camera. So it's very dramatic, and also isn't her head shaved?
The cameraman actually reaches out and pulls off her wig in the scene.
Okay,
from
so
behind
it's like a PO.
Camera.
Okay, yeah. So it's a PO. Okay, thank you. Okay, so there's Sam Fuller in the pages of film culture. Then all of a sudden that stopped, and it became totally about avant-garde film culture, specifically Brackage, like generation of Brackage, and then the structuralists. And there I was at the time. I mean, I moved back to Los Angeles in 1969. There I was in Los Angeles making movies that alluded to the industry. It was as if film culture couldn't bring itself to admit that there was such a thing as the industry, or that it could somehow be made use of, or that it could be made to be self-critical. It was a kind of taboo. And the films were shot in sync, which at the time was a very unusual thing for an avant-garde film to be. My films were shot in sync. Although this did begin to happen. Like Owen George Landau's films, some were in sync, and then later there were people like, Michael Snow. And then also some Hollis Frampton is in sync. But early on, it was a very, very strange thing to be making films in sync. I don't really know this for sure, but my guess is because the attitude was that sync was, it only, that it not only reproduced what a Hollywood film looked like, but that it involved, it really wasn't in itself progressive because it only gave you the world as the world already looks. And Peter Kabelka has talked about this. He's on principle, he is an enemy of sync because of the doubling.
It's illusionism, right?
It's not just that it reproduces the world as it already looks, but of course it's just moment by moment the world as it looks, and then the constellation, it's a movie, and that's not how the world looks, believe me. But Peter Kabelka is, he's hostile to sync because in his view the image and the sound double each other. If you see the image, there's no need to hear the sound because the image implies the sound. If you hear the sound, there's no need to see the image because the sound implies the image. And he's written about this. So much of his practice is based on creating relations between images and sounds that are totally unrelated to them, and this juxtaposition creates new meaning for both the picture and the sound. And I embraced sync. I never questioned it. And I don't know where this came from. I went to a very conservative film school where sync was the norm because you were being trained to go into the industry. But on the other hand, they also, the other side of this, or another side of it, was they also insisted on the primacy of editing, which I totally rejected. My films are not, well, one is. One is.
From my, 2003,
well,
right?
I'm thinking of a film I made in 1974, which I don't show much because it's a little tedious, but my films reject editing, which I would say that editing is, so to speak, an attribute of composition. You're controlling what people see and hear in order to control their relationship to it, and construction is rather a different model.
So the construction of picture and sound rushes is very distinct and focused on the problem of sync, or
So rushes is a term used in the commercial film industry. It's what you shot the day before. They're also called dailies. So rushes, it's an industry term, and it consists of the four relationships that are possible between picture and sound when you, in fact, are in production. And they are sync, where you shoot picture and sound simultaneously. Picture only, which is called MOS, which stands for emit out sound. And it's an industry term. So when you shoot a scene, I mean, all Hollywood films ultimately appear to be sync, but that doesn't mean you shoot everything in sync. A car chase, you don't shoot in sync. You add the tire squeals later. So you shoot it silent, which is to say you shoot it MOS. And then there's a corresponding term for sound, where you record sound without picture, and that's called wild sound. And not because something unhinged is happening, but because the motor is not a sync motor. A sync motor automatically records at 24 frames per second. But if you're like a tape recorder, an ordinary tape recorder is more or less sync, but it's not actual sync. So if you wanted to, so it's not literal sync. It's not like machine sync, so to speak. So if you want to record like a gunshot, you don't bother to shoot it in sync. You just record it, and then you sync it up with the smoke coming out of the barrel in the cutting room. So you record the sound separately, and that's called wild sound. So picture and sound together, picture only, sound only, and then neither sound nor picture. So there's no sound, and there's no picture. And this fourth combination is implied by the other. So this is a film that goes through these combinations. So it's one quarter of it is no sound, no picture. It's a black screen, and the track is dead. It was made by what was in the recorder when they were making the optical track was just celluloid film. It's not mag with nothing on it. It's nothing. So the film goes through these various combinations. And during the course of the film, I talk about how it's constructed. But it's pure Saul LeWitt in the sense that it's the exercise of combinations and permutations. And the early work, I mean, Saul LeWitt's early work is just so important to me. The moment I saw it, I was convinced by it. I just, okay, I get it. And it was hugely important for me. And I'm thinking about the work with like pencil leads in different colors with different combinations of lines, you know, vertical lines, horizontal lines, diagonal lines going this way, diagonal lines going that way, and then all the combinations. And they're worked out exhaustively. Whatever the combinations are that are promised, you see them realized in the work. And there's a writer on abstract painting to whom I owe a very great deal named Yvan Bois, and Bois, in talking about LeWitt, quotes someone else, I forget who says, in LeWitt there is no et cetera. So when LeWitt says you are going to see all these combinations, you see them. Well, this one is just, these are easy, because it's only four different cases and they're arranged in all the possible combinations. And it was a 200-foot roll of film, because in the cutting room, although there's no editing involved, I added the black leader. I mean, half the film is black, half the film is picture, half the film is sound, half the film is silent. And of course, by sound, I mean either sound in sync with an image or sound by itself, and picture is either. And so you get it. And
so the industry doesn't have a name for the fourth type.
Yeah,
but
so,
you had to.
Yeah, so rushes is an industry term. Sync is an industry term, MOS, wild, all industry terms. There's no industry term for the absence of both picture and sound during production, because you don't need it. They don't make movies with neither picture nor sound in Hollywood. So I had to invent a term, and I called it the null case, N-U-L-L, the null case. And the film is modular. When you take all the different combinations and you divide them by the ultimate length of the film, which will be 400 feet, each unit, it's a modular film. Each unit is 27 and 3/4 of a second long. And the camera operator and the sound recordist each had the chart, so to speak, or the score, and they turned their machines on and off. So it wasn't as if we shot the whole thing and then lifted out picture and replaced it with black, and lifted out sound and replaced it with celluloid leader. It wasn't like that. It's like literally when there's black, the camera wasn't on. When there's silence, the camera wasn't on. Or the tape recorder wasn't on. And so it was performative to that respect, in that respect. It wasn't just me who was performing, it was also the camera operator and the recordist. And so you're made aware of them as they turn their machines on and off. And also at the beginning of each sync segment, a man stuck the equivalent of a slate in the shot. It was a little light, and you press a button, and the light goes on, and it makes a bloop. So I'll be talking, and all of a sudden, you see this light, and you hear bloop. And people are always amused by that, because it's totally, it's incongruous. But of course, I had to leave it in, because it was exposed during the sync segment. Oh, you'll notice that the head of production stills, in the very first shot, you see a slate. You see the assistant holding a slate. So there was a slate at the head, and I cut it off. Maybe that was a mistake, but, you know. So to the extent that I cut the slate off, I was enacting the Hollywood model. I got to cut the slate off. You know?
Composing your film.
Well, yeah, anyway.
So the so many of these early films explore different aspects of production, but the work has also been very much on the space, focused on the space of exhibition too, and the conditions of exhibition. This is still from a work called Projection Instructions, 1976, and you've called this a score to be performed by the projectionist in a way. What does that mean?
I don't know if I ever consciously realized this, but I understood it afterwards. Even the most radical movie, I mean, the most radical, weirdest, farthest out, trippiest movie you could ever imagine still depends on the model of self-effacing projection. In other words, even if the original production is transgressive, let's call it, or even if you process your film in bleach or whatever it is you do to engage in some kind of radical project, in the end it's projected on the model of concealing the act of projection. So even if you're willing to bring into visibility or to interrogate or question the act of production, the act of reproduction, the act of projection is invisible. And one of the ways to look at my work is that I look at an unexamined assumption and say, well, what if we examine what has been an unexamined assumption? And the unexamined assumption is normal projection. So the film consists of instructions to the projectionist. And so it's performed by someone who ordinarily we only notice when they make mistakes that upset us. And we yell focus and things like that. But this is all the film. All the film does is to show you things that make you aware of the projectionist, because they are all violations, so to speak, of the unwritten law that governs projection, which is that it makes itself invisible as it makes the work of the projectionist invisible. So when the projectionist, it's in sync. You see this and you hear someone, it's me speaking, throw out of focus. And so what should happen then is that this is thrown out of focus. So you can't read it anymore.
We tried hard to make that possible here, but they told us they can't do it.
Because
it's a digital projector.
And other instructions are frame up, frame down, turn the lamp off, which freaks the projectionist out because, well, you know, but on the track you'll hear me say, turn lamp on. Turn sound off, turn volume up, turn volume down, turn tone to treble, turn tone to bass, frame up, frame down, and then combinations of them. And it's short, it's 4 minutes. So it's like turn volume up, turn tone to treble, or turn tone to bass. And the more extreme, the better. I mean, if it can be made really loud and really bassy, that would make me really happy. But people tend to be timid, you know, like they don't want to throw it so far out of focus that they can't read it. But you don't worry, the film won't abandon you. It won't leave you marooned and out of focus land. The instructions will be there to bring it back into focus. They'll be on the track, focused normally.
So it's another suspense film.
It's a suspense film, yes.
Yeah, right. a panic room film.
Yes.
If you've ever been a projectionist before, right? Let's skip ahead to what many would probably describe as the culmination of your early film activity, and that's a film from 1984 called Standard Gauge, which you've also called a sort of autobiography, but also a history of the industry that would make it possible. Can you describe the source material of this film?
Yes. For a while, I was an editor in the industry. I did it to earn a living. I was the associate editor on The Student Nurses, executive produced by Roger Corman. And the director was Stephanie Rothman, who at one time was thought to, was held up as a feminist filmmaker. And she made a number, there was another nurse film, then she made Treasure, I think, Group Marriage, Velvet Vampires, and some others, I can't remember the titles. And I worked on a film called Messiah of Evil, which for some people, I don't understand quite why, is a cult film. And in fact, Woody Allen, there's a film by Woody Allen, he makes a joke about it. He's visiting in Los Angeles, which, as you know, he despises. And he passes a movie theater, and on the marquee, it's Messiah of Evil. Well, I think the joke's on him, but let's not tell him. Let's not spoil his self-regard by telling him. Messiah of Evil was made by two people I went to. I went to film school with one of them. And then he married someone who was at the other film school, UCLA. And he was, this guy was quite successful as a writer, quite young. But then they were broke, and so they wrote a script, a spec script. They wrote a script hoping they could sell it. And his agent said, let's make a movie. So they raised the money, and they made this horror film, Messiah of Evil. And so in my work in the industry, I mean, there was a time when I was fascinated by 35 millimeter film. These two films were shot in 35. And 35, just as a format, held a certain fascination for me. I think a part of it is that the images are big enough that when you eyeball the film, you can see something. That's not true of 16, not for me at least. You need a magnifying glass. But 35 has, just as a format, has for me a kind of power. And so I started collecting things, bits and pieces of this and that. I found in trash bins. I mean, there was a street in Hollywood called Seward. There were lots of labs. So there were film, there were bins filled with film that was being thrown out for this reason or that reason. So I collected these pieces of film, and I didn't know what to do with them. I was just responding to some kind of compulsion, and in the end I decided I could make a movie about them. It was essentially a kind of show and tell. So what the movie showed, it was done on a light table, an improvised light table, and what the area of the film was about this, and then, so what you saw within this was a piece of 35. And there were, I don't know, 25 and 30, maybe more than that, pieces of film. And so I would look at one, and then I would comment, and then I would sometimes scan down to find more things, and then I would remove it, so that it was an empty frame, just the light table, the white of the light table, and then I would put in another piece of film and talk about it. And I think it's fair to say that this is the most conservative of my films. As it happens, it's also the most popular. It's conservative in that, to the extent that it's autobiographical, it tells a story. It's about what I was doing when I found these pieces of film. And it's also, it's essayistic in that it treats a subject, and the subject is like the gauge itself. It begins with a long, long crawl which explains the origin of the dimensions of 35 millimeter film and how it came to be called standard gauge. And it's also funny, which is deliberate. I mean, my other films are funny, but I mean, Picture and Sound Rushes, believe me, is a laugh riot, but it's not intentionally so. It's because I'm interrupted, I'm suddenly cut off, or else there'll be a sequence where there's nothing on the screen and no sound, and all of a sudden you hear a fragment of only sound of me speaking, and it cuts in mid-sentence. So and then there's the bloop light, which, you know, interrupts me and is this silly little thing that is a distraction and humorous in itself. But this was deliberately funny, and I had to write it. The other films I didn't write. I didn't write production stills. It's an act. It records people making a movie. For Picture and Sound Rushes, I didn't write it all out. I spoke from notes, which accounts for this unbelievably awkward performance of mine where I repeat things and I say sort of. I don't know how many times I say sort of in the course of Picture and Sound Rushes. But it's improvised from notes. But for production still, for standard gauge, I wrote it all out. And I wrote it in order to achieve certain effects. So in relation to what I will call the purity of some of the early films, this is a very different story and a very different kind of film. And now comes the important part. It used to be that the longest load in 16 millimeter was 1,200 feet, which is 33 minutes. So in 16, you could have a longer take than you could in the commercial film industry. The longest load in the industry is 35 millimeter is 1,000 feet, which is the equivalent of 400 feet in 16. It's 11 minutes and 6 and a fraction seconds. That's the longest you can shoot in a Hollywood movie. Not anymore, but in the old days, that's the way it was. But even then, in 16, you could do a shot that was three times as long as what Hollywood could do. So Hollywood, for all of its resources, could not do what you could do in 16, which is to have one continuous shot that lasts for 33 minutes. And this film, in fact, is 32 minutes long. I couldn't quite fill up one single roll, but it's and one continuous, uninterrupted take that's more than half an hour. And the film doesn't tell you this directly, but one of the things I did do was to look for examples. When I had examples that could be related to long takes, I included them. For example, I include a piece of it's the end of a reel of a film by Alfred Hitchcock called Under Capricorn, which has very long takes in it. Rope has even longer takes. I point out that Hitchcock was interested in sort of working against, so to speak, I'm sure you all know Rope. Rope was, it gives the impression of being shot in real time as if you were watching a stage play. But because of the limitation I mentioned, there have to be cuts, but they're hidden. They're hidden or else they fall within the convention of conventional movie making. For example, there'd be a close-up of Jimmy Stewart, and then there's a cut, and he's looking, so we want to see what he's looking at, and there's a cut to Farley Granger, for example. I don't know if that, for example. And we understand that a cut like that occurs in real time, so we accept that as being temporally continuous, and the whole film is temporally continuous, and furthermore, it's the impression of being temporally continuous, and furthermore, it's all shot in the same space, except for the first shot, which is an exterior. So Hitchcock was interested in, it's like Rear Window, who's, you know, it was a stage play. In a way, he was against the conventions that govern movies. I mean, one of the things, movies let you cut from here to there, you know, with a cut from one place to a place far removed. And Hitchcock, I think, was determined to show that it didn't have to be that way. I mean, the film Lifeboat is the same way. It's almost all shot in a lifeboat, not literally, but the greater part of it is. Rear Window. Everything was shot within the apartment except, I think, for two shots that come at the end. Yeah, so you can make a movie with a camera inside the same room. And so he accepted this kind of, let's accept this limitation, but then show that it's not a limitation. And Under Capricorn has very, very long takes, or not as long as in Rope. So I included this little bit from the end of Under Capricorn without telling you that it's by Hitchcock, because of course you would know, oh yes, Under Capricorn, Hitchcock, long takes. And And then I talk about the last scene in Detour, a film by Edgar G. Ulmer that I hope you all know. It's one of the great film noir. Not because of the long take, but because there was a very remarkable occurrence with respect to the sound. The sound, at the beginning of the scene, it's an interior monologue, which is produced by a convention. You know, there's a close-up that moves into the character's eyes. The scene is suddenly lit in a way that we see only the eyes, and everything else is dark. And then you hear the character's voice. So there's an interior monologue. And that continues as he leaves the cafe and walks along this road. But two things happen. First of all, what he says produces a kind of disjunction in the time of what we understand as a continuous shot. So all of a sudden, I mean, obviously in a continuous shot, what happens later is the future in relation to what's already happened. But what happens in this shot is that it's what he says makes from that part of the scene from then on so much later that it's as if the scene is showing us something that is quite distinctly a future in relation to what had been the time of the shot. And then at the same time, the character's monologue, it moves from being an interior monologue to being as if narrated by someone who's not in the movie. A narrator conventionally is someone we never see. It's like movie music. It originates in the same space. Unless it's a character in the movie, then it's different. But in this film, it starts out as an interior monologue, and then it becomes this other thing where it's as if it's delivered from outside of the world of the movies. And this is all in relation to a single continuous shot. What I wanted the film to do was to demonstrate that a single continuous take is not the simple event that we might take it to be. And this is one of the reactions against Warhol, was a Warhol film shows us what we already know, that this is what something looks like. Which, when you think about it, is just unbelievably naive. But that was an early criticism of Warhol. I think I'm right, aren't I?
Yeah.
Well, what's the big deal? Where's the art, That it only reproduces what we would see if we were there to see it. But, so of course this omits the fact that severing it from the real world and seeing it as an image in itself transforms what it is that we're seeing. And this piece of Scene Missing came from Messiah of Evil. And you use Scene Missing if there's going to be an insert or a pickup. There's a thing in studio filmmaking called a pickup, where something you meant to get or should have gotten, or you have to reshoot because it didn't come out quite right. So you go back and you pick it up. So it's after principal photography. But in the meantime, you want to stick this piece of Scene Missing in. So when you're looking at the cut, you know that ultimately something will go there. That will be a shot that will be correct with relation to what has gone before and what comes after. Now, don't worry, we're going to do a pickup. But for now, this lets you know that there will. So it's a kind of placeholder to let you know that ultimately there'll be a shot there that you need. So yes, this came from Messiah of Evil.
Morgan, I'm interested in thinking about how these notions of non-composition, or how the formats and structures of things given determine the work in other media. In particular, painting for you, which came to you in practice somewhat later in your career, but was very much an early ambition as an artist?
Yes, yeah. That was my first ambition in visual art, was to be a painter. But I didn't know how to do it. I didn't go to art school. I didn't know how to do it. And into the 70s and into the 80s, there were plenty of absolutely hideous examples that are not. We don't want to do that, for sure. Robert Ryman, that's good. Good work, Bob Ryman. Good work, Ed Reinhardt. Good work, Blinky Palermo. Good, Ellsworth Kelly. Hardcore abstract painting. I admired them immensely, and the question was, could I ever do anything about it? Could I ever find my way to do something that I wouldn't be embarrassed to show to people? And in fact, this work on the floor was my very first painting that I can that I can own up to. I found it's a self-portrait, and it's a monochrome, I point out. I thought that monochromes were a particularly important model because they in themselves avoid composition, but then the question is, what are the dimensions? How to arrive at dimensions in a way that in themselves do not enact a composition, but are, so to speak, that they come from somewhere. I didn't choose that. I take no responsibility for that. It was given to me. And I found a book published by Geigy Seba, it's a Swiss pharmaceutical company. It included a chart that for a given height and weight gave you the surface area of the body in question. And so that gave me the painting. So it is as long as my height, and then the width was determined by dividing the area by the height.
And you conceived that somewhat earlier than these other paintings.
And this was 1994. And it's a painting, but it's not a painting you can hang on the wall. It was first done in a parking lot, so it got driven over. I'm all for taking paintings as seriously as possible. I mean, I'm going to be really sentimental. I think that great painting is a very noble thing, and the people I've mentioned, I think, are examples of that. Oh, I should have mentioned Bryce Marden, too. But this is a somewhat, what's the word, sort of sardonic look at the monochrome, because you're not going to see this held up in front of an audience at Sotheby's because it's paint on the floor. And so it's a kind of casting down of the seriousness of painting at the same time that it fulfilled my interest in work that's constructed, as I would say, or at least is not compositional in the conventional sense. And this other work is 1999, and the dimensions were determined by a standard size in photography. It's 20 by 24. And they're monochromes, and they have these irregular shapes because these are the dimensions of books. Guidebooks to Italy. I did 10 of these, and altogether the paint. I love this. I mean, I'm so happy with this title. Altogether, they're called the Italian paintings, which of course summon up pictures of plain air painting in Tuscany or whatever it is. But in fact, this is what you get.
None of them made in Italy.
Yeah, none of them. Yeah, these were all made in Culver City. Just like when MGM, when it says made in Hollywood, USA, MGM was in Culver City. Yeah, forget this Hollywood USA. Although there was a time when Culver City wanted to change its name to Hollywood. Hollywood is a place in Los Angeles. It's not an official, it's just a neighborhood. It's a neighborhood. But yeah, Culver City wanted to change its name to Hollywood. So yeah, made in Culver City. And so the cutouts, let's call them, were the sizes of these books and then the sizes of their shadows. And it's mostly a matter of carpentry, as you can see. And then the paint was Benjamin Moore Alcid wall paint, put on with a roller. And I'm sure you know that industrial means are one of the modes of radical abstraction. Putting on paint with a roller, for example, or with a spray gun. That was to come. Spray painted paintings were to come, but. So these paintings were made with a roller. And the painting itself was very, very fast. It was mostly a matter of carpentry. And they were shown and they were made. There was 10 of them, and they were divided into, there were four groups. There's two groups of three and two groups of two, which I point out already calls into question the notion of one painting that a painting necessarily has to be a singular instance. And of course, I think this connects up with minimalism, but I think in painting it's a little different because it's a way of making you think about the differences, the similarities and differences, and also sort of reckoning, so to speak, with the fact that they're physically separate from each other. I read somewhere recently that Rosalind Krauss just talked about how in Haroon Faruqi's video work, when your eye has to move from one monitor to the next, that your eye having to cross that gap between one monitor and the next is already a sign of postmodernism. And I'm not sure I would agree with that. I would much rather think that it's possible to insist that there can be painting with under the sign of modernism in which there's one more than one element, so to speak. And here I'll just, while I think of it, I'll just mention that so some of Frank Stella's work was made in groups and shown in groups. There's the pieces with, they're the like the, you know, the pentagon and the hexagon and so forth with concentric rings that correspond to the canvas shape, and in the middle there's a hole that corresponds to the shape of the canvas. And these were made as a group and shown as a group. So these paintings, so to speak, support each other. They're all individual instances of a more general idea. And one of those paintings together, I think, are far, far more than the sum of their parts, and certainly far more than just a single instance. So these were offered for sale, but you couldn't buy just one. You had to buy a group, at least two.
So this this almost perverse search for motivation in every aspect of the work that we see in the early film work and these paintings continues in different formats as well. Some years later, Morgan produced a series of aspect ratio pieces that are mirrored panels that are determined by the standard formats, again, the standard gauge and image sizes of the Hollywood industry. Why did you choose to execute these works in mirror in particular? I'm thinking of like the somewhat arbitrary choice to go gray for the Italian paintings and mirror for the aspect ratio pieces.
Oh, I should mention, it wasn't just any gray, it was 18% gray. So it's like middle gray, it's like gray is an industrial standard, in fact. 18% gray is middle gray. It implies the world of the visible. You can make a correct exposure by basing it on middle gray, because it embraces, in theory, it embraces everything from dark subjects to light subjects. And this came about because I was offered a show at Carol Green, Green Naphtali in New York. And so I had made paintings where the size, about the Italian paintings, they're not rectangular. I mean, they are, but they're rectangles minus. And in movies, you're stuck with a rectangle, I would say. It's a very rare film where the frame is not rectangular. I mean, I can't think of any offhand. I don't count mats where you see like a binocular, like this, or a keyhole. We don't count that. But so paintings are rectangular for the most part, except Stella started to break away from that. And so I was interested in the non-rectangular, and I had used architecture as a source to make the size and shapes of paintings. So there were paintings that were shaped like the letter L, but a thick letter whose size and whose height and width were determined by the door or window next to which they were hung. So the painting also had to be hung in a certain place. So the paintings were against the idea of something that can be put anywhere, which is how we think of paintings. I mean, not frescoes, of course, but when you buy your Picasso at Sotheby's, you can put it wherever you want. Well, not with these paintings that had been done in relation to architecture. So it struck a blow, so to speak, against this presumption that a painting can be put anywhere. And I was invited to do a show at Carol Green's, and so I looked at the architecture, hoping that the architecture would give me the work, and it was not a very interesting space, and I would have been repeating myself at that. Then, like, what to do? And then I thought about aspect ratios, and aspect ratios are industrially determined. When you shoot a movie, the aspect ratio has already been determined for you When you make a painting, you can make the painting any shape you want. If it's a rectangle, any proportions, any size. Hollywood or, you know, film, it's not the case. In 16, it's 1 to 137, I think. In 35 originally, it was 133. And then there's things like Technoscope and Technoscope, American widescreen, European widescreen, Todd AO, CinemaScope, Panavision, Ultra Panavision 70, which is 2.76 to 1. Hateful Eight is shot in Ultra Panavision. So that's very wide in relation to the height. And I thought of making paintings that referred to the movies. And of course, as I've already mentioned, movies are devoted to keeping you from thinking, from realizing there's anything outside of the frame. There's no world outside of the frame. It's the movie's organized to totally absorb. So you don't even see the edge of the frame. You're not even aware of it, that the image stops here. And so I thought of making gray paintings that were aspect ratio, so at least you would see the edge of the frame against the wall of the gallery. So you would be, even though it's a movie aspect ratio, you would be seeing it in a way that you didn't see movies. And then, all of a sudden came the idea to do it in mirrors. And that's what I did, and not only that, but the name of the ratio and the ratio expressed as a number is sandblasted onto the face of the mirror, like a little label in the lower right-hand corner. That's a different series, yeah. So it would be, European widescreen 1.6, 1.65 to 1, for example. And so a couple of things happen. First of all, when you look in a mirror, you're not looking at the surface unless you're cleaning it. When you're cleaning the bathroom mirror, you're looking for the smudges. So you look at the surface. But when you look in a mirror ordinarily, you're looking at yourself. You're not looking at the surface, so you're looking through the surface. And if you're in a gallery looking at this work, you're looking at yourself. So you have an excuse, so to speak, to be in public and look at yourself. And also what happened is as you could move around. Or a mirror tells you where to stand as you stand in front of it. But you don't have to. You can look at a mirror obliquely, then you see something you don't see yourself. So even though there was the, and of course movies, when you see a movie, you don't have a choice in how you see it. It's already been determined by the angle. So in this work, there was the allusion to movies, but you could control what you saw in the frame, which alluded to the movies. And as you moved around, the image was cut, so to speak, by the edge of the frame in different ways as you moved to different positions. So all of a sudden, you could see the edge of the frame in this thing that was a kind of quasi-movie-like experience in a way that you are never meant to think about the edges of frames in a commercial motion picture. And the only question was how big to make them.
And the answer?
I thought I didn't want them too big. I didn't want them too small. So, okay, why, there's a work by Duchamp by three standard stoppages. Why is it the length that it is? It's a meter. It's a standard unit. Yeah, so it's not an invention. It's a unit given to him already. So for this, I thought 1 foot high is too small. 2 feet is okay. So it's 2 feet, and then the width is whatever the aspect ratio is. So Ultra Panavision 70 was 2 feet times 2.76, and that's how big the pieces were.
So maybe by way of conclusion, we could talk about some of the most recent photographic work you've been doing, which I think echoes maybe the earliest work that we did look at, the film Cans and Boxes, stenciled spray paint drawings. But I wanted to ask you as well, visiting your studio, you realize that Morgan is an avid collector of all things cinematic and photographic. He has a world-class collection of color handbooks and manuals as well. What prompted you to take on this project of photographing old expired film boxes?
This work is, it's obliquely autobiographical. I had earlier done, when I was a kid, my father was an amateur photographer, so I grew up in a house full of photography books. Above all, annuals, like the U.S. Camera Annual. There was a time when this was a very prevalent form. It was kind of the salon tradition, but in book form. One page is a photograph by someone, and the other page is a photograph by someone else. And I grew up with these books. And I had done a project before this where I had done tracings of ads from some of these old annuals. I mean, specifically the ones from 1952, 53, and 54. And it's very much a record of things that have totally disappeared. I mean, Ansco no longer exists. Ansco Chrome no longer exists. Flexichrome, which was a process developed by Eastman, no longer exists, and so forth and so on. So it was very much a record of something that has vanished, but done in the form of tracings, which was an allusion to the form known as camera lucida drawings, which was a kind of predecessor to photography. The man who invented the negative positive process, Fox Talbot, had used a camera lucidograph, which was a kind of tracing. You looked at a scene, it projected the scene, like when you're traveling in Italy, you're a gentleman scientist, you're traveling in Italy and there's Lake Como, and it projects onto a piece of paper and you trace the image. So what you're left with is a drawing. And Fox Talbot was, I think he wanted to do away with the work of tracing. That's a part of it, and I think, and so that's, and I, Daguerre, I guess, had already done his work, and so Fox Talbot was prompted to find his own way of doing things, where there was this, in effect, there was a kind of automatic inscription. In fact, he called his first book The Pencil of Nature. And I've written about this, and I say, well, there was a time when photography was the camera lucida, that Lucy drawings, lucidograph drawings, were seen as a kind of photography, and that early photography, at least by Fox Talbot, was seen as a kind of drawing. I mean, I make this claim. I mean, a historian would just laugh at me, but so what? Making claims is, it's fun. It's good
for you. The artist's work, yeah.
It's good for you. So I was interested in how photography is. And my father taught me photography when I was 12 years old with a good camera, so I knew about depth of field and f-stops and shutter speeds. And when I learned photography, Kodachrome, on a brilliant, brilliant, sunny, cloudless day, it was a 50th at f8. That's how slow Kodachrome was. It was ASA 10, I think. But anyway, so you know, all this, it's in the process of vanishing, as film is. And so I had done this work of tracing, and then I also, at the same time, I did the work for a show with Stefania Bartolomei, and there were two aspects. The other part of the show was rubbings of covers of British photo annuals. There was a series called Photograms of the Year. They were the British equivalent of U.S. Camera Annual. And I did rubbings of the covers. So it was, so it's the same size. They're like this. You know, it's like tombstone rubbings. That's what I was thinking of. That's one of the classic subjects for rubbings is tombstones. And then the other part of the work, so, you know, there's this very, very black, it's like a 6B lead. It's very, very, very black. And then because the titles are stamped on, there's this little shadow of lettering, Photograms of the Year 1950, and so forth. And of course, over the decade, the conventions of typography changed and the design changed and so forth. But this was the decade when I learned about photography. It was also a decade when I became, technically speaking, an adult, sort of, because I was 8 in 1950, and in 1960, I was 18. So, and then I thought, well, kind of related to this idea of things passing away and vanishing is photographs of film boxes, all from the 50s. And these are all intact, they're unused. And I found them all on eBay. And what attracted me to them, I think, was was the pathos of waste. These have remained unused, and now they're too old to use. So something that was made to be used in a certain way never was used. And so to me, there's a kind of pathos of a lost opportunity. I mean, someone bought a roll of film to use, they never did. You know, so there's a narrative there which is totally unavailable.
And the process of translating the object to an image, how did you come to that? Rather than, say, present the film boxes on their own. I mean, there's a there's a kind of perspectival reference to your earlier isometric drawings as well.
Yes, and the background is 18% gray. It's not a gray card. It actually, there's a company in New York called Color Aid, and gray number 5 is in fact an 18% gray. And I wanted them, so it had to do with controlling how they were seen and being very formal about it. Mm-hmm. And it's like here. It's like here is something for you to look at. So, and of course, there's a model of product photography as well. But you know, product photography is about encouraging you to buy something that you will make use of. I mean, I did in fact make use of these. But anyway, then I realized that I could turn these images into negatives, which I did with Photoshop. They were shot, I didn't shoot them, the originals, the positives. They were shot on Ektachrome by a professional photographer. And then the prints are archival pigment prints. And I realized that they can be turned into negatives. And because it's an 18% gray, because it's exactly the middle, the negative of 18% gray is the same as a positive. And it's embarrassing that I did not have the presence of mind to be able to anticipate this. But I'll confess, it didn't occur to me. It's not as if I got the idea to turn them into negatives, and then I was able to visualize in advance that the gray would remain the same. It was more like, well, let's see what happens, and this is what happened. And so there's a second series which is exactly the same images, the same size, except they're all negatives. And so to me, this is about discovering the other side of what is, I mean, every minute our eyes are open, the world we see also implies the negative that we can't see. And it's just, it's there. It's just that we don't see it. But one of the things I've done as a result of doing this work is to try to visualize things, like what will this look like in negative? And if it's a yellow flower, I can do that. I mean, that's such a yellow, I mean, that's blue, in fact. You know, there it is, right there. Yes, yellow and blue. That's another example. Something green, magenta. See, I have to think. It's embarrassing. People who work in motion picture labs don't have to think. They can just do this without thinking. But anyway. It's another kind of richness, let's say, to me. And in fact, my discovery of this has led me to want to do a whole bunch more work in negative with different subjects. But not maybe just four or five bodies of work, not an infinite number. My concern is that this is a gimmick. And to that I say no.
Well, if it leads somewhere, you know.
The fact of the matter is that didn't Wallace Berman do work in negative, I think?
Yeah, with the Xerox machine.
Yeah. There have been people who have worked in negative. I actually did work in negative at the end of the 60s when I did the film boxes. There used to be a process in the graphic arts called photostats, and a photostat was always a negative. And no one thought anything of it. But the usual subject of photostats is like documents. And so you can read a negative of a typewritten page just as easily as you can read a positive. So it's not as if you wouldn't think about it. It doesn't interfere with your perception of what the object. Blueprints are negatives. No one ever had a problem reading a blueprint, even though in fact it's a negative. But I think the negative applied to an unfamiliar subject, it sort of slows down your engagement. You can't take it in quite as fast. And it helps, I think, that it has text in it, so you can still read it. You still know what it is. But it's showing you what you thought you already knew in a way that you had not seen it before. And to the extent that it's showing you something you hadn't seen, I think I'm happy that the work can do that.
Morgan, I think we should take a couple questions.
Okay. Can I just mention one more thing?
Yeah.
I found an app called Negative Me. I highly recommend it. It's just fabulous.
So there'll be some microphones coming down the aisle. Please make sure to wait to get the microphone to ask your question.
Hi, thank you. The question I'd like to ask is, you look a lot at the standards of production. And I was wondering if I could get you to comment on the standards of exhibition. We saw production still screened here in a theater space, but we see it in a small black box in the gallery where you can walk in at any point in a loop, where here we see those 11 minutes play out in a linear fashion.
It's ideally, the movie wouldn't begin until you're in the theater, or you're in the box. And ideally, you wouldn't leave until it was over. But that's not the way people engage with moving image work in a gallery context now. And I think that's a very great shame. It invites a kind of drop-in attitude, which I think is harmful. I gave a paper about this once. I saw people, there was a time several Whitney biennials ago, there was a selection of biennial of moving image work shown in Santa Monica, at the museum in Santa Monica, the Santa Monica Museum. And I went to experience it and observe it. And if I had seen all of the, and they were all playing simultaneously, if I had seen every single one from the beginning, I would have had to spend the entire afternoon there, because as you move from one to the next, even if you see that one from beginning to end, then you come into the next one and you're in the middle, and so forth. And this encourages, people will look in the room, and if their attention is not instantly engaged, they leave. It's as if they're looking at a painting. You can see a painting in an instant. I mean, at one time that was the model. I mean, Kenneth Noland. I mean, that was the model as Greenberg understood it. You saw it and you got it all immediately. But that certainly isn't true for some kind of painting. And it certainly isn't true for almost all moving image work. And I think it's a very, very great shame. One way things can be done is that when you enter a room, you press a button and the movie begins. Then if you decide to leave, well, okay, that's your business. And then it runs until it gets to the end, then it stops. So then it's ready for the next person. So nothing happens until you decide to push the button, which I think inclines you to make a certain kind of commitment. But what's absent for sure is the old model, where you had to leave your house and travel some distance and buy a ticket. I mean, you were committed. You were committed to staying with what you had invested the time and effort to come to see, and that's gone, and I think that's a very sad thing. But having said that, there are some movies that you can engage with. You can have this drop-in attitude. I've actually made a movie like that. It's a loop, and essentially the same thing. It's like watching a fountain. It's the same thing over and over again, but a little different, and it's very clear that it's not going anywhere, and so there's variety and movement, but it's not as if it's tending to, move toward an ending. And people understand it, and they look at it for as long as they want, and then they leave. And they're also, they can so that doesn't trouble me. But yeah, it's a shame. But I don't know what to do about it. I think actually people are more willing now to give time to moving image work that they encounter in a black box than they used to. So something has happened that people, I think, are more inclined to have the patience. I hope.
Other questions?
Thank you. It's a fascinating lecture. I'm wondering about the particular film you made with the long black space with no audio. So you called it what, the null?
Yeah,
the null set.
Yeah, yeah. I called it the null case. That doesn't occur all at once.
Right.
The question is,
I'm interested in the reality of that. How do you define the space? Is it a particular formlessness? Is it beingness? Is it nothingness? Or is it just kind of a, as you mentioned, a particular film gimmick? Is it?
I hope I didn't call it a gimmick.
Because it's really a fascinating temporal time there where nothing is going on. But how is it defined for the viewer in terms of reality?
I don't know.
Well, a lot's going on in the cinema, right? In your seat.
I mean, to me, it's simply absence. It's absence. It's the absence of picture. It's the absence of sound. And as I say, I mean, there are, by coincidence, there are 24 separate segments scattered throughout the film. So there are six segments of each of the four different cases. But the six segments of any one case don't occur all one after the other. They're all intermixed. Although, as it happens, it becomes sinks, sort of disappears, and then the null case becomes more prominent. So at the end, in the last quarter of the film, there's far more cases, instances of the null case than in any of the other quarters. So there's more instances where there's 27 3/4 seconds, as close as the operators could do it, looking at the timer, in the last quarter than there are in the preceding three quarters. But I mean, to me, it's just absence. Another way of looking, I just suddenly thought of this, another way of looking at it is it's the idea of scene missing but enacted in the abstract. So instead of a piece of film telling you scene missing, it's the total absence of the film, but it's a kind of placeholder. It's a placeholder. It's not going to last forever. You know, sound will return. Picture will return, maybe picture and sound together. So to me, to me, the black isn't a picture of a space. It's like an absence. But thank you for making me think about this. I mean, I never really thought. I mean, I think you're inviting me to think about it as a picture, which never entered my mind. Have I responded
yeah,
to?
Yes, awesome.
Okay,
that's a good response too.
Yeah.
I'm wondering whether the concept of coincidence has any emotional resonance for you.
In general, you mean? Yeah, I mean, yeah, I love coincidence. I mean, coincidence, it's a gift. It makes me happy. But if you're asking me how to connect that with my work, I'm not sure I can do it.
You might talk about parentheses, which we skipped over.
Okay.
Which has a chance element.
Okay, but I do. If you're trying to rescue me from an awkward moment,
No, not at all. I would like to hear it too.
So we're distinguishing between chance and randomness and things like that. Or, I mean, do you know something about me that I don't? I mean, is this?
I think I do.
You can tell me in front of all these people what it is that you know about me.
Well, I started out by thinking about choice and how it seems like you have confessed that choice makes you terribly anxious as an artist.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I mean, looking at a dinner menu makes me unhappy.
But then when you construct rather than compose, you are inflicting choice on your viewer, which is interesting.
Inflict. Offering them the gift of...
But you don't consider choice a gift.
No, I don't, but let me see if I can... It's not as if I feel I have to talk my way out of this. I think I can be... I'll just go back to how it began. When I started making work, what I found, for whatever the reason, the model that my work accorded with the most was the model that I will call construction, which is against composition. And now why I was drawn to this, I do not know. Or why I found it so powerful. When but it's what happened. I know I'm not dealing with your question, but I don't know quite else what to say.
No, thank you very much.
I mean, for example, if I have the feeling you're a little upset with my work.
Oh my gosh, no. I find your ideas so interesting, really, that I just wanted to, provoke you into talking a little more about them.
Okay, well, fine. Okay, well, all right. Well, thank you so much, but they're not my ideas. they're ideas that are already at large, they're models or sources that are already at large in the world. And I mean, don't give up. If you want to give me a hard time, please feel free to try some more. No, I'm serious. I'm happy to be put on the spot.
As I say, I didn't mean to put you on the spot, actually. I wanted to play a little game, I guess, because I feel like games are also part of your strategy, like game theory or coincidence or...
Well, rules, for sure. I mean, yeah. That's one way to think about LeWitt. It's totally about rules. I don't know what else I can say. I mean, tell me what else to say and I'll say it. I just want you to... I want you to be happy.
I am so happy.
Okay, good.
Well, okay. Maybe another question will...
Yeah.
Okay, great. I want to follow that up because you're saying sort of like here you are doing construction as opposed to composition. So construction certainly is a series of choices. But what I want to really ask you about is a more personal thing, which is sort of like the arc of your ambition. Like, so I mean, the thing says that you start off as you're studying art history at Harvard, and certainly it sounds like you're going to spin into the art world. It's something that you want to do. Harvard's so proximate to New York City, late 50s, early 60s. Why would you not go to New York? But you don't. You don't go down that route. Instead, you go off to Los Angeles, if I'm getting the story right, and kind of work in the film industry.
Yes.
And it's like you're not really going for this art ambition that you seem to have, that you seem to completely be. You're working against it. So I'm curious as to sort of how you came to define yourself as an artist and give yourself the liberty to do the work that you wanted to do as opposed to doing something else for a living. Or was sort of like the LA thing, Hollywood thing, just strictly a mercenary sort of like, I want to make money, so I'm going to Hollywood to be in the film industry.
No.
So it's like, how did your artistic ambition grow?
Okay. I made paintings, or I did work when I was an undergraduate, And for the most part, it was really awful. I mean, truly, truly awful. And I made one painting that I still have, which was, and there's work I wish I still had, but I've lost it. I've actually thought of making over again work that I made in 1960. It's like, is that just a totally bizarre idea? But I have to decide whether or not to do that. Like lost work that I made in 1960. Most of the work I did is what I will call an artist, involving paint and a brush and so forth. It was totally without interest, except for a work that I guess reflected my admiration for early Philip Guston, who I still like a lot. And then it was gouache on cardboard, on Strathmore board, I think, or whatever it was. And after I finished it, and after the paint had dried, so far so good. It's a kind of, I mean, you do this when you're young. You sort of recapitulate the work that you venerate, or at least that's something one does when one's beginning. And after I finished it and the paint had dried, I held it upside down, and I had a match, and I ran the match underneath the painting so that I was altering the surface of the painting without seeing the result of what I was doing. And I didn't understand then that that was actually something interesting. I mean, never mind that, what's his name, you know, Eve Klein was doing flame paintings and all that. This is very different. I had made a painting, I was damaging it, let's say, but the form of the damage could be seen as something positive. And it was also involved a lot of chance, because I could not see what I was doing. And I didn't realize that, in fact, maybe this was something interesting. So, you know, but it didn't, I still have the painting, and I'm not ashamed of it. I think it's, you know, I like it. I'd also made some films in 8mm, and I just felt more confident about them. As awful as those were, I felt more confident about them. The only art magazine that I knew about at the time was Art News. And what I saw on the pages of Art News, I just didn't know how to respond to it. Although, in fact, there was a review of a very, very early show by Robert Morris, including, I think, these sculptures that consisted of large wheels with spokes made of what? Were they plywood? Were they wood, these early Morris pieces? It was, and that's where I saw Ed Reinhardt for the first time. Was in the pages of Art News, I think. But then there was an article about a second generation abstract expressionist named Norman Blum. And as much as I loved Pollock, but you know, that's that. No one can, you know, don't, sorry, that, you know, no one can, that there's no way you can go beyond that. You have to start somewhere else. And I just didn't know what to do, but so I went to film school because I pictured that somehow made sense, and it didn't have to do with money. It had to do with supposing that it was possible to do in this country something like what Godard was doing in France, and that was absolutely out of the question, which I didn't understand then at the time. And at the time, the model of an American independent film, the only one that I know about at least, or knew about then, was Shadows by John Cassavetes. But it turns out that was the exception. And as you know, he went to Hollywood and he made some not very interesting films before he finally found a way to make films that were more to his liking. I think he made A Child is Waiting. I think that was directed by John Cassavetes. And then there was maybe a couple more, and then he somehow found his voice, the voice that we all remember him for. But I loved looking at paintings. I grew up in the Midwest, but by chance I was in New York in the summer of 1960, and there was a show at the Guggenheim. I forget what the title of the show was, but it was a show that involved, it was School of Paris plus some French painters. And so there were canvases that were kind of ripped and twisted, and then the paint was just slathered on there so it looked like shiny mud. And there were paintings by people like Soulage and Mathieu. And I just loved, I had just turned 18, and it made this gigantic impression on me. I loved that work. But at the same time, it had the quality of being the exhaustion of certain possibilities. I mean, now let's be honest, it's not a very kind thing to talk about, but you know, people like Soulage and Mathieu are not particularly revered these days. I mean, and I also liked, I love Nicolas de Staël, and people have given me a hard time for this, for liking de Staël. Well, I've seen some paintings by him that I think are fantastic. So I had contact with like this sort of late moment in abstract expressionism, and then the continental version of this. I think actually it included, how do you say, Tapies? Is that how you pronounce it?
Tapies, yeah.
Tapies, and who are some other Spanish people?
Like,
And there was also Fautrier, I think.
Fautrier was
French, someone I saw in the same show. It's just heaps of paint as just stuff, you know, just this, you know, just, yeah, so you know, paint as material, just, and there was a Fautrier show in New York maybe, I don't know, 10 years ago, and the paintings were shown horizontally because, you know, what was, and they were signed on all four edges so that there was not the automatic orientation you get when you see a painting on the wall. So it was this very different understanding of what a painting was. And I hadn't seen that work then, but I liked that work. Yeah, just, you know, paint as stuff held a very great deal of appeal for me. But I was always interested, and the question was, well, so, you know, Robert Ryman, what do you do? You like Ryman? What do you do about it? Well, you can't do that. You know, you like Bryce Martin, what do you do about it? It wasn't as if I was actively thinking about all these things, but I think, in effect, that's what it amounted to. Like how to sort of enter what you can think of as being that history without, and being in good faith about it, without being ironic or, yeah, without being ironic or without doing work that expresses the impossibility of there being future work. I mean, that's one of the strategies now. It's like, let's make work about how we can't make work anymore. I'm like, that interests me not in the least. I think that's, yeah.
Well, Morgan, thanks. I think that's all we have time for today. But I'm sure he'll be happy to stick around and answer some other questions one-on-one. But let's thank Morgan Fisher for coming out.
Well, look, Eric, thank you again, and thank you all for. Thank you, really. I'm very touched that you came. That you're here, and thank you for the questions. Thank you for making me think. Yeah, so thanks. Thank you.